Hey everyone, I'm Samyak Agarkar and welcome to Agarkar Media Academy. This is the 11th tutorial in Blender tutorial series. So in the last tutorial, we saw an introduction to shading and we gave colors to the objects that we had added in the 3D viewport. So this is what we did in the last video. We just gave colors to all the objects and this was our last render, right? So this was what we did in the last video. We just gave colors to all of them. Now in this tutorial, we are going to dive deeper into the shading tutorials, shading part. So again, let's just add, we basically already have a cube and we are not going to change that this time. We just want to look at different things that are possible inside of shading mode. So let's go to the shading layout, shading workspace from here. And as soon as I'm in a shading workspace, we can see that we are already in the material preview mode here, from here. This is the wireframe mode. This is the solid mode, solid shading mode. This is the material preview mode. And this is the rendered mode. Right now, we are in the material preview mode. We can see the materials. Now, the default material is already on it. The color of the cube is already white. And now, we are just going to change the color. We already saw in the last tutorial that we basically have two nodes by default. One is principled BSDF and the other is material output. So material output basically has three things, three possible inputs: the surface, volume and displacement. So surface gives colors to surface, volume gives volume colors and other type of shading to the volume, and displacement gives displacement to the object. We will look at volume and displacement in the next tutorial. Right now, we are just going to focus on all the options inside of principled BSDF. So, BSDF has to be joined to the surface right now. Always remember, always join the same colored inputs and outputs to each other. If you join yellow to, let's say, violet or yellow to green, it will not work. There are other nodes inside of this node editor which we can add to, you know, convert, let's say, yellow to orange and some other colors to the color that we want. So we will be looking at all those nodes also in the next few tutorials. Right now, we are just going to look at the principled BSDF. So we already saw in the last tutorial, the base color changes the color of the object, right? So if I just hover over here and I just change the color, you can see here, the color of the object changes. We can increase or decrease the brightness from here. Completely down is black, completely up is white, and if you are at the center, then it will be completely white. Otherwise, we can just move in here or there. Let's say you want a darker brown color, then red, and increasing the blacks will give a darker brown color. So you need to just look at all of these. If you have a hex code from somewhere from online, then you can just tab on here and give the hex code that you want. If you are familiar with RGB, then you can also give the RGB colors right here also. The best way is to use this or use hex colors from you know, material UI designs and all that stuff, right? Then we have the subsurface. We will not be looking at this just right now. Let's move on to the subsurface color. Again, if you are just adding some subsurface, then the colors of that subsurface will be changed. We are not looking at it just yet. We'll be looking at it afterwards. Metallic is the metallic color, metallic node. Here, either we can increase the metallic nature of the node or we can decrease it. Metallic will give it a shine and also make the object look more metallic. So that is what metallic is all about. So if you look at, you know, if you have a let's say we just change the color to red, and if you ever look at a red metallic color, then red metallic color always looks like this. It is never this red in the metallic color. If you have this red in the metallic color, then that's possibly a painted color, right? But a red metal would look like something like this, somewhere around this, right? So this is the use of metallic color. So it basically gives metallicity to the shading of the object. Then we have specular. Specular is all about reflections. So how much reflection is possible, that is defined by specular. So if you just decrease the specular to zero, you can see there is no you know, reflection going on. If we just increase the specular amount, then you can see some amount of reflection can be seen here, right? Then we have the specular tint. So the reflections that happen, that can be given some amount of color. So it's not directly visible just right now, but when we make some beautiful objects, then we can increase or decrease the tint of the specular or the shadow, the reflections that it is having. Roughness gives the roughness of the object. If the roughness is zero, it will be completely a mirror like object. As you can see here, I have decreased the roughness to zero, and now it is just mirroring the object. Here we have an environment texture going on, which we can see on the object also. If you just go here and just click it here, you can see some default environment textures that are available for the material preview mode. So let's just select this grassy surface, and now you can see here some grassiness can be seen here. If I just change the color to white, it will be even more prominent. And if I just give more metallic nature to it, now it becomes a complete mirror, right? So a mirror is a metal with zero roughness or some very slight amount of roughness, but a zero roughness is better, right? So this is all about. Here you can see the reflections that are possible on the metallic surface. So this is all about roughness, how rough your object is. Let's change the color to red again. It's orange, but yeah, red. Now, anisotropic is basically when there are reflections, you can see some anisotropic, what we call it as some textured, which are there, which is defined by anisotropic. So it is not prominently visible just right now, but when we'll be looking at even more shading options and we'll be setting up the complete entire scene, then I'll be showing you how this anisotropic actually works. So if you have seen the cuts in the what we call it as a metal aluminum plate, at the bottom of the metal aluminum plate you can see the circles that it has. So it reflects just on one side, so that is defined by anisotropic. Then again, sheen, you can just change, increase or decrease, and you can see how different it basically does. It is just about sheen is all about the corner reflections that are possible. Clear coat, if you want a clear coat on your object, then the clear coat, increasing the clear coat will increase the shininess. So even if you have some amount of roughness, clear coat will give some amount of reflection to it, because a clear coat is basically when you have a rough texture but you have added a clear coat over it, it will be shiny, but not as much shiny as a completely rough object would be. So even if I have here, I have increased the roughness to 100%, but just because I have some amount of clear coat here, you can see some amount of shine that is being possible. If I just remove the clear coat, then you can see there is no shine at the in the object. But just because there is some clear coat available, some shininess is possible. So that is just to give some amount of realism to the object. Otherwise, just roughness would do everything. Clear coat roughness, if you have a clear coat, then how rough is the clear coat? IOR is all about a internal reflection. So if you have some objects which are transmitting the colors, then IOR is good. So IOR basically needs a glassy surface where internal reflection, refraction can be added. So if you are looking for windows or fluids, then IOR is very, very, very necessary. Transmission is how transmittable the object is. So it is not completely directly visible in the EV render engine. So you just need to come up here and change the rendering engine to cycles. And as soon as you go to the cycles rendering engine and just change the mode to rendered mode, now you can see some amount of color that is being transmitted through. Just let's add an object, scale it up, and let's move it down. Now you can see some amount of color that can be transmitted through it. So now changing the IOR will give different results. IOR is all about how refractive the surface is, how refractive the object is. So just increasing or decreasing the IOR will give you different results. So IOR of 1 is a complete transmissible object. So it's just transmitting with some red amount of color on it, right? But a mirror is never completely one having a IOR of 1. It has some IOR. It is sometimes 1.2, 1.3. And you just need to look up at the IORs of different objects. So if you are using a glass, then the IOR for glass is different. For water, it is different. And that will give some realism to the transmissions that is happening. So the light passing through it. The next is emission. Let's just decrease the transmission to zero and roughness to full. Emission is all about how emissive the object is. So emission is basically creating a light. It just glows, right? So if I just do it here, so now you can see that the object itself is giving out some light on the surfaces. So here you can see the object is itself emitting some light. So we have given it a color of this, and this is the color that is being emitted by the object. So you can make emitive objects through the emission. Of course, there is a way to, you know, attach some other nodes here also, and that will give everything. Normal is all about how the normals. We'll be looking at it in the next lecture. Clear coat normal is, again, if you have this using this clear coat and you just don't want to add one value to it, but you want a texture that should be used as a clear coat normal, then that can be done. And same is for the tangent. So we'll be looking at these three prominent textures and PBR textures honest in the next lecture. So this is all what we learned in this video. The best way to learn all this is just go around and just play with all these all these options that are available in principle BSDF. And as soon as you do all of these things, you will be able to understand what's actually happening. It's all about practice. Once you have a practice of everything, you will be able to do a lot better things in Blender. So this is all about it. Thank you for this watching this video. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you haven't yet subscribed to this YouTube channel, please do subscribe. Please do share this video with your friends and family so that they can also learn to create awesome stuff inside of Blender. We are just going to cover everything inside of Blender from the start, from the very beginner's perspective, so that anyone can learn and anyone can create awesome videos, 3D animation videos and VFX videos inside of Blender. So if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you have any suggestions or queries, please comment down in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching this video. See you in the next video. Till then, keep smiling and keep learning.